you're going to get a good quality care.
Well, I'm joined now by Dr. Char Nagpal, Chair of the British Medical Association Council, Stephen Dorrell, Chairman of the NHS Confederation, and a former Health Secretary, Professor Sir Chris Ham, Chief Executive of the health charity The King's Fund, and Kate Andrews, News Editor at the conservative think tank, the Institute of Economic Affairs. Welcome to you all. Good evening. If I start with you first, Dr. Char Nagpal, you had a chance to watch the debate, the questions that were raised. What was the overriding message that you took from the debate this evening?
Well, first of all, there is huge support for having a National Health Service, and it's a source of such pride that the values and the principles of a service that can provide care to the entire population, universal care, those values are still held deeply with the population. But there was also recognition that we've reached a point where the NHS certainly doesn't have the resources, the infrastructure to deliver what the population needs and wants and what doctors would like to provide. So it's actually how we bridge that gap. And that's what I feel is the real debate at the moment with regards to the NHS.
And Professor Sir Chris Ham, how is that gap bridged? I know it's a huge question, but what are the areas that perhaps need to be concentrated on to bridge that gap?
Well, the NHS needs to spend more, and the Prime Minister's made a welcome commitment to increase its budget. It also needs to reform to develop new ways of providing care, much more integrated around people who've got complex needs, and a much stronger emphasis. This came out in the studio discussion tonight on preventing people getting ill in the first place. If we could do far more in that area, we'd reduce the demand on hard-pressed GPs like Dr. Nagpal. We'd help hospitals deal with the winter pressures they're always under.
And Stephen Dorrell, a welcome announcement of the Prime Minister, but is it enough?
The short answer to that is no. The NHS Confederation sponsored some work that was published 6 weeks ago that showed that in order to deliver sustainable service and a service that meets the aspirations we have for it, what's required is both 4% real terms in the health service, but also critically 4% real terms growth in social care. And that underlines the key point, I think, that there is virtual political unanimity in support for the principles of the National Health Service. But what we do need to do is to re-embed healthcare in the full range of public services that serve local communities. Social care is the one people often talk about, but it applies to housing, it applies to education, it applies to the full range of services that communities rely on. That's how you deliver health. You can't subcontract health to the National Health Service.
So clearly a complex picture, and Kate Andrews, it's not simply about pouring more money into the NHS, is it?
No, it's not. And I was delighted to see the results of the Sky News debate tonight, that people voted to say this isn't simply about increasing taxation.
46% yes, more funding from taxation, 54% no.
Exactly. And I think Sean Worth hit the nail on the head when he said that the conversation around privatization has been totally manufactured. Nobody is calling for the privatization of the NHS. I agree with you. Everyone recognizes the importance of universal access to health care. But people are clocking on to what's happening in mainland Europe, that all of these countries have universal access to health care, but they have different systems, more efficient systems, better outcomes when it comes to patient care. They have shorter waiting times. And yes, perhaps some more money needs to go into the health service, but they don't want it to go into a broken health service. They recognize that we need reform and improvements to make this best for patients.
Why and the rest of Europe?
It's quite clear. We've, for the last 8 years, not invested in the health service. We've been increasing expenditure each year by about 1.1% when it should have been around 4%. So we've had 8 years of austerity by the government's own acknowledgement. And what we are left with is a service, when you compare ourselves to European nations, of tens of thousands fewer doctors. Germany has three times the number of hospital beds per 1,000 patients compared to the UK. France, twice as many hospital beds per 1,000 patients. And we also don't have the facilities. You know, the European averages have twice as many MRI scanners, CT scanners, compared to the UK population. So in fact, you know, it's no surprise we're not able to provide the same level of service when we don't have the infrastructure of doctors, nurses, beds and facilities.
Why don't we recruit more?
Well, there's actually a global shortage of doctors and nurses. So there are all over the world, people are saying what we need is more doctors, more nurses. It takes a very long time to train doctors, and just going out to recruit more doctors and more nurses in the in a global marketplace, we'll find every other advanced country and a lot, every country is out there trying to recruit doctors and nurses. So that's another reason why we have to think about how the health service relates to other public services. I agree with what Dr. Paul said about the NHS funding needing to grow in line with demand. But we can't look only at health service funding. It has to be seen in the context of social care and other public services, because if those don't get the funding they require, what happens is that services, demand for social care services or for social housing services isn't met and is diverted into the health service. That's what fills the GP surgeries and the A&E departments. Too often people are going to the health service because other public services aren't meeting
but
their demands.
Back to the results of the vote tonight, the public realizes that if £20 billion extra a year still isn't enough money, where does this stop? And the Institute for Fiscal Studies has been very honest about the fact that this can't just come from the rich, because the rich are already paying over 50% of income tax. It's going to come from everyone. And if you funnel that into a system that is not fit for purpose, people years down the road are going to turn around and say, where did my money go? And the NHS has been lagging behind European countries for decades and when it comes to really serious issues like cancer outcomes and stroke outcomes and things like that. So it isn't simply a matter of more funding. It never has been. The UK has one of the most centralized systems when it comes to healthcare in the world. It's not very pragmatic. It doesn't use the market as it should to get those efficiency gains. And patients are suffering.
So not, I was going to bring you in, Professor Chris Ham, not simply a matter of funding, structurally, issues need to be addressed.
Yes, but I disagree with Kate, because we've been trying to use markets within the NHS for over 25 years now, since Ken Clark and Mrs. Thatcher brought them in the early 1990s, and all the evidence suggests that they haven't worked. In fact, they added to the complexity and the cost of funding and providing care. The Prime Minister at the Royal Free Hospital only 10 days ago said, this is the end of the market experiment. We're going to use collaboration, working in partnership across the public sector.
That's it. So Chris Ham, we're going to talk much more after the break. Do stay with us for our debate. Much more coming up.
I've lost my wife, my daughter, my job, my whole life to this stupid bloody thing. Lucky me.
The new series, Stan Lee's Lucky Man, Friday the 20th of July on Sky One. And if you missed out on the first two series of Lucky Man, both seasons are available now with Sky Box Sets.
This is gonna take a bit of getting used to, but I know what's right for you.
Fly. At Go Outdoors, save up to 60% on tents, clothing and footwear. Our summer sale is now on. Go Outdoors, you can't beat it.
This is what luxury included feels like. Chefs are creating masterpieces. The staff are making their finishing touches. Bartenders are shaking things up. Butlers are preparing for your arrival. When can we expect you? Sandals, the five-star luxury included resorts. Call 0800 742 742.
For travel, I trust Kayak. They search hundreds of travel sites to find the best flight offers for me. For everything else, I trust myself.
Major cybercrime attacks are often reported in newspapers and on TV. Every time you're online, your private information could be stolen, sold, or exploited. That's why you need NordVPN. Help stop others seeing your transaction details. Help protect your family's online activity and keep your personal details safe by preventing your information from being tracked online. NordVPN. Protect your family with advanced security on up to 6 devices at just $4 per month. Install NordVPN today at nordvpn.com/TV.
Whatever your next step, take it with the new Ford EcoSport. Our next step in small SUVs. New Ford EcoSport. Together, we go further.
Welcome back. Well, earlier tonight, Sky News held a debate on the future of the NHS. We'll get more from our panel here in a moment, but first, a flavour of what we saw earlier.
I just don't think pouring in more and more and more money is the answer, right? It's a, already we're going to have to get the equivalent of about 9% on all of our income tax just to keep the Prime Minister's current promise to add more taxpayer money into the NHS to basically dig it out of the hole it's currently in.
What we do need to get better at is planning for the long term, not just for the funding, but also for our workforce, and thinking about where we can invest the money most effectively to get the best for patients and come back to patients and what they need.
The issue with the NHS is not that it needs to be shaken up and reorganised and everything else, or you know, the model changed, you know, everyone accepts and likes the way we get free care if we need it and it's very equitable. The issue is, can the NHS keep up with the demands that we're continually placing on it, and can it embrace change, new technology?
The arbitrary rationing we've seen in the last year, the cancelled operations, that's going to get worse, and you're going to see more people opting out and getting private health insurance. That's going to create a two-tier system with one standard available for the affluent and one standard available for everyone else.
Let's bring our panel back in on the future of the NHS as it celebrates its 70th birthday. Dr. Charan Nagpal, Chair of the British Medical Association Council. Professor Sir Chris Ham, Chief Executive of the health charity, the King's Fund. Stephen Dorrell, Chairman of the NHS Confederation and a former health secretary. And Kate Andrews, news editor at the conservative think tank, the Institute of Economic Affairs. So before the break, there was a point, Dr. Nagpal, I think you wanted to come back on that Kate had made, really looking at comparisons with other nations. How are we doing when we measure up against others?
So as I said, we know that we don't have enough doctors, nurses, hospital beds, facilities. But I want to talk about the market that Kate mentioned, because I think that one of the crucial elements of funding is to stop wasting current NHS resources on market processes. It's been estimated that several billions of pounds are spent on the processes of market transactions. So even last year, to give you a simple example, in Nottingham University Hospital Trust spent £500,000 of taxpayers' money to bid to provide a treatment centre service. And Virgin also sued the NHS for not winning a bid. Now, we can't have a system where we don't have enough money to treat patients adequately, and at the same time, money's just evaporating in these wasteful transactions. So I think it's really important to put an end to those market processes so that resources are available for patients.
And Stephen Dorrell, do you think that type of problem might be solved with more of a relationship with the private sector? Should it not be a dirty word?
Well, I think we need to remember the private sector has been in a partnership with the National Health Service since the day the health service was founded. And the simplest way of making that point is that when you go to a pharmacy in the community to have your prescription dispensed, you're going into a private sector contractor working within the National Health Service. And that model repeats itself many times over in the health service. The health service has always been a public-private partnership. And it needs to, I agree with what Sean Worth was saying about the health service to be open to new ideas. But that's, of course, not to defend pointless processes, bureaucratic processes. The question is, if you're spending public money in order to secure free healthcare on behalf of citizens, surely you have an obligation to find the best way of using that money to deliver the objective we all share for the National Health Service.
Kate, what are your views on private involvement? Sean Worth, as we said, he was saying that there needs to be more private investment in the NHS.
Well, if you look at the social health insurance systems in Europe, I think they pretty much get it right. The government guarantees the funding for healthcare so nobody goes without, but the private sector is allowed to bring in the provisions of healthcare to actually run it. I just completely reject this idea that the NHS is struggling because of market mechanisms. When you have a monopoly dictating everything that a theoretically private group or body has to do, that is not a market. Marketization in healthcare hasn't failed. It's successful all over the world. There's a reason that no other developed country has adopted the NHS. There's a reason that tens of thousands more people's lives are saved each year in different European countries because they have better, more efficient systems. And my last point I'd make is about losing doctors and not having enough NHS staff. They're leaving to go to better systems that address their needs. So rather than trying to stop that, why don't we import the Australian system or the German system to keep workers here?
Very interesting point, Professor Chris Hamm. Why has no other nation adopted the National Health Service?
Well, the reality is every country chooses the healthcare system and the funding model that fits its culture, its history, its traditions, its ways of working. The NHS works for us. It wouldn't work in France or Germany.
Why wouldn't it work anywhere else?
Well, the New Zealand system actually is very, very close to the National Health Service model, so I don't think it's quite right to say no other country has emulated what we've got. Look, if you look at the data, look at the facts on this, the NHS does we as a country choose to put into it. Let's not knock the NHS model. It provides universal, comprehensive, free at the point of use services. All the surveys say few people in this country are deterred from going to see the doctor because they're concerned about the costs of paying the doctor. We've removed those financial barriers. That's what Bevan aspired to do back in 1948. It's a huge achievement. We have got work to do on our cancer outcomes, on our stroke and heart disease outcomes, but we're narrowing the difference over the last 15 years. The investment we've made, more doctors, more drugs, things are getting better. Let's look forward with optimism. We've achieved a huge amount. There's more still to go for.
Just finally, in terms of the politics of the NHS, we all know that it's very dear to each and every one of us and holds a very particular place in our hearts. We've had it referenced by Ed Miliband as being weaponized. It really is at the core of our essence. In terms of politics, would you like it to be apolitical so that all parties came together to work? Oh, you're shaking your head, Stephen Dorrell. Could that ever work?
I don't think you can ever take the health service, or indeed healthcare, out of politics in any democracy. You can't take it out in this country. What's the most important political issue in domestic politics in America? The answer is Obamacare, because it's about access to healthcare. So I agree with Chris Hamm, that we have a system that works for us. What, in terms of our payment model, what we have to do is to be open to new ideas about how we can make that more effective.
I also think we should be proud of what the NHS does better than any other nation, where you have international studies saying that it's the fairest system in the world, where in fact the access to healthcare from a low-income individual to that on a high income is actually completely fair. That is not the case in other nations. We should be very proud that we have a very low level of. I don't think that the difference between us and other nations is about the market. The market would, in fact, I think, waste even more resources. And we have plenty of evidence of private providers that have provided services in the NHS and walked away when they found it not profitable enough. That happened in Cambridgeshire recently. After 3 years, Circle walked away. That ends up causing disruption. So I don't think that the issue for the NHS is that the model's wrong. It's absolutely right. But no system can actually function if it hasn't got the infrastructure. And if you remove the infrastructure from France and Germany, they wouldn't cope either. In fact, you know, they'd probably do worse than we do. So I think we need to get the basics right and be proud of a system that is fair, its values are absolutely right, and it's equitable and it's coordinated. It just needs the right approach.
We are coming to the end of our debate. So, Professor Sir Chris Ham, we found from our research and our audience that they think the glass is half full when it comes to the NHS. Are there positives?
There are lots of positives. We should be really proud of what we as a country have achieved in 70 years and look forward with confidence to the next 70, particularly maintaining the good things. Free care at the point of use covers all of us. It's comprehensive. We should mend the holes in the fence, join up the care, more priority for prevention and improving people's health and well-being. And let's make sure, as Stephen Dorrell has said, that social care comes into that as well, because the ageing population needs social care in many cases more than healthcare.
Well, we certainly haven't answered all of the questions we've raised, perhaps more than we've answered, but the debate will continue. Panel, thank you so much for joining us for the 70th